Macmillan Audio presents I'm Possible, a story of survival, a tuba, and the small miracle of a big dream. Written and read for you by me, the author, Richard Antoine White. To Cheryl White and Richard and Vivian McLean. Prologue. I'm Possible. I button up my tux and the world shifts. For a short while, everything moves at half speed. I walk slowly. I sit slowly. I speak slowly. I conserve my breath. Buzzing into my mouthpiece, I walk on stage and I am greeted by the plumage of red seats, soft and inviting. Slowly, quietly, the audience bubbles into the theater, which is aglow. They hush at the sight of us holding our instruments, flipping through the sheets on our stands, or closing our eyes, trying to get close to the music one way or another. I play the piece in my mind, letting it unfurl, just as I want it to when I put my lips on the brass mouthpiece of my tuba. I inhale an epic breath and allow myself fleetingly to think, I have made it. The lights dim. The crowd settles. The conductor raises his arms and the hall pulses alive. The harp, the piano, the woodwinds, flutes, oboes, clarinets, and bassoons, the strings, violins, violas, cellos, and bass. The percussion, snares, xylophones, bass drum, and timpani, the brass, trumpets, French horns, trombones, and tuba. All of our voices become one. One powerful voice that draws everyone present into a whole other world of hope and passion, sadness and joy, and possibility. People pay attention when you say, I'm the first. You know, the first in your family to go to college, or the first woman to be president. In my case, I'm the first African American to earn a doctorate of music in tuba performance. And when I say that, people pay attention, and sometimes they assume that I'm a genius or that I am special. Based on how my life began, I can see that my musical journey seems like a minor miracle, that even the fact of my survival is some kind of marvel. But the most miraculous part of my story is not me. It is the people who kept me from falling through the cracks, the people who saved my life, the people who cared enough to take me in, to teach me, to push me, to tell me something I wouldn't have otherwise known, and to challenge me to be better. I'm no different from the next person, although I do possess a profound belief in what is possible and a deep gratitude for how I came to be here. The first time my life was saved was on the day I was born. My mom was 17. My biological father was 19. He got locked up before I was born. And when I arrived in the world, he wasn't there. I was born premature at Berlin General Hospital and weighed just over a pound. Richard McLean, the man who raised me, said he could put me in his hand and close it. He would tell me, boy, you had all those tubes hooked up to you, coming out your nose, going into your mouth, and I would just feel so bad every time I went to go see you. Yes, sir. Sure glad you made it. Mm-hmm. The second time someone saved my life was a few months later. I have a small scar just to the right of my navel, a flat keloid scar that's as much a part of my body as my little finger or my nose. I can't remember a time when it wasn't there, but I never knew where it came from. Richard McLean's son, Ricky Jr., told me that when I was an infant, the McLean family got a call from someone in Sandtown, Pennsylvania Avenue, the neighborhood in Baltimore where I'm from, saying that there was a baby screaming in an abandoned building. Everyone knew that my mom had a baby and that she had alcohol problems, and no one wanted to call Child Protective Services on her. So they called the McLeans. Ricky Jr. came searching for me. The house was just a burnt-out shell. And when he found me, there was a mischief of rats swarming around, nibbling on my side. He shot at them. Bam! Bam! And they scattered. And he was struck with the fear that the shots would damage my hearing. It turns out, my ears are okay. To be honest, I have a great ear. I have my mom's ear. Cheryl could really sing. And she'd sing all the time. She introduced me to music, and she also instilled in me a powerful sense of determination that carried me through all manner of trouble. We didn't have an apartment or a room that we had a key to. There was no place with a lease in my mom's name. Sometimes we had shelter, but it was never a home. At the end of the day, I didn't know where home was. All I had was Mama, and from a very young age, I had a profound urge to protect her. Though I knew she had an illness, I believed that I could take care of her. But first, I had to find her. There weren't any tricks for that. I would simply search every place I could remember. Oh, she might be in the park. Oh, she might be under the tree. Oh, she might be at this house or that house. I searched on an endless loop until I found her. Sometimes it would get dark before that happened, and I would just crawl into an abandoned house and sleep there. That searching taught me perseverance. It taught me to keep working a problem until I solved it. Sometimes I feel like I do things the hardest way, but I never forget how to do them. I also have a tireless sense of optimism. I know that everything is possible. I want you to hear this story and feel like you are a superhero. I want you to hear this book and dream big, impossible dreams. Looking at the beginning of my life, everyone would have thought it was impossible for me to survive, impossible for me to succeed, impossible for me to be who I have become. But here I am, standing on stage, playing the tuba, living a happy life. I am possible. And therefore, I know that anything is possible. I am possible. You are possible. Everything is possible. Part 1. Grow Great. By the time I graduated from high school, my dream was to get an orchestra job. I didn't know that it is easier to get into the NBA than it is to get into a symphony orchestra. Your odds are even worse if you're African American. Less than 3% of orchestra musicians are African American. And while there might be 32 violinists in an orchestra, there is usually only one tuba. Finding these jobs is like finding a needle in a haystack. But that's what I wanted. I wanted it so badly, I could taste it. I started professionally auditioning in 1996, 10 years after I began to play the tuba. To audition, you must be invited to play for the committee. When I tell you that I was invited to audition in Albuquerque for the New Mexico Symphony Orchestra, it sounds rather elegant. Maybe you're pitching a handful of musicians in their tuxes, so it is important that you understand that these weren't auditions of only the elite. They were cattle calls. I scraped together money for the plane ticket, the overweight luggage fee, and the oversized luggage fee to fly my two tubas in their hard cases. I stayed with an old friend, Peter Landers, and slept on his couch. The next morning when I showed up at the old church the orchestra was using for auditions, I was herded into the warm-up room with 10 other tuba players who were all auditioning for the same job. And we were just the first batch. In an hour, another 10 people would show up. The committee probably heard 30 or 40 players that day. I drew a number from a big glass bowl just inside the door to see which batch of players I would audition with. For a beat, we all looked at one another. Then the latches on our cases were sprung and the room exploded into a cacophony of sound. Bwop, shomp, shomp, boo, 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 bee, 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 ooh. People were running scales. They were fluttering their lips, buzzing into their mouthpieces, and emptying spit valves. The warm-up practice room was a flurry of sound and saliva and nervous energy. I took a moment to put my heavier tuba by the door to the audition stage and returned to the bwop, shomp, boo, bee, oo of the practice rooms. I learned that trick after having to walk to several auditions from the cattle room, down the hall, up the steps, down the steps, and around the corner, carrying two tubas, only to sit down on the stage already out of breath. Eventually, the audition proctor popped his head in the door. Group two, he called out over the pandemonium. Five of us moved toward the door, everyone lugging their two tubas. I carried my lighter tuba and followed the proctor slowly, focusing on my breathing. Sometimes the proctor would offer to carry one of the tubas, but even then, they walked fast, and I would appear on stage to play short of breath. So I learned to set the pace and walk stupid slow. The audition room was a church pulpit. There was one chair, and the excerpts were arranged on a music stand. A black curtain portioned the church in two. The screen was there, so the auditions were truly blind. The auditioner's voice was not allowed to be heard. Even their footsteps were not allowed to be heard. The church's floor was wooden, and there was carpet spread over it, so the committee couldn't hear the click of women's heels or the squeak of sneakers. The committee didn't know the race or gender or age of anyone who played. There was only music. I knew it was there to protect me, but I had the urge to see the screen come down. I wanted to see the faces on the other side when I, a 250-pound black man from Baltimore, broke their hearts with the sound of my tuba. I waited at the side door as the first person in our audition group played. The church was quiet. He whispered a question to the proctor. The proctor announced it to the audition committee, seated on the other side of the screen, and the committee gave their answer. Then the tubist lifted his instrument. When it was my turn, I played the first excerpt, then the second. After the third one, a voice behind the curtain said, "The committee would like the candidate to play the excerpt again, focusing on the rhythm." I thought to myself, "You're telling me I suck, but do it again." My nerves were sparking so that I couldn't think about what they wanted me to change. I played it again, and it was identical to the first time. The auditioning committee couldn't see me, and I couldn't see them, but sometimes I could hear them. A cough, a snicker. "Thank you," someone said dismissively. Over a decade of work and $1,000 to travel here, and within 5 minutes, I played all five excerpts and was sent on to the room where I sat waiting to hear if I was good enough. One by one, the other musicians filed in, and then the proctor came back and announced the names of the musicians who would advance to the next round. He did not say my name. I had gone from homeless on the Baltimore streets to studying for my doctorate in tuba at one of the most competitive music programs in the world, but I still wasn't on the level. I thought about a piece of advice Professor Ed Cord gave me right after my very first orchestra audition in Indianapolis. If you want to get to where you've never been, you've got to start doing the things you've never done. I went back to work, practicing 5-6 hours a day. I was going to bring that screen down. I was going to win an orchestra spot, but first I had to grow great. Chapter 1, On the Move. The water fountain rose above me. I eyed it, and in one swift move, hoisted myself up on the stone ledge, then let my toes dangle until I felt the smooth, cool pedal, arms trembling. I gulped water and scrubbed the stray drops into my face. Mama wasn't at the park. She wasn't at the light blue row house with the peeling paint where she'd been hanging out the night before. And she wasn't at the big tree on Riggs Avenue either. I'd woken up alone, curled between a tree's roots early the morning after having fallen asleep, listening to Mama laughing with Roxy, and they passed a brown bag between them. My stomach growled. The last thing I'd eaten was half an egg sandwich yesterday morning when I found Mama on the marble steps in front of a gray-painted brick building with boarded-up windows. I started up Carlton Avenue, Maybe Mama would be looking for me at Grandma Bernice's. In the morning, we were like a magnet to a refrigerator. We found each other always. From an open window, the smell of bacon hit me. I eyed the trash basket. No one was looking, so I scanned the nest of bags and cups and greasy wrappers. Last week, I'd found a box of chicken wings with the wingtips fully intact, and I'd sucked the meat off each of those bones until they were clean. But on this morning, I found something better. Beside the basket, a coin. And then another. I snatched them up and tucked them deep into my pocket, where I had a few others. Maybe there'd be chicken gizzards today.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.